Next tonight, a debate over smoking. Today, millions of Americans were asked to put out their cigarettes for the day in observance of the 11th annual Great American Smokeout. Some smokers aren't being given a choice on whether or not to light up, however, as more and more state and local governments consider ways to restrict public smoking. One such restriction that the Congress is considering is a partial ban on smoking in airplanes. In a moment, we will debate the merit of that proposal, but first we hear from correspondent Tom Bearden, who recently asked some travelers through Denver what they thought.
Smoking is not permitted on the concourses or the main terminal building, except in designated areas. Thank you for your cooperation.
Denver's Stapleton International Airport has long confined smokers to specially marked areas, but the regulation is widely ignored. It would be harder for smokers to ignore some of the proposed laws that would ban smoking in flight. One calls for a $1,000 fine. When we asked smokers what they thought of the idea, the reaction was mixed.
Well, we should enjoy. I smoke, so I guess I should have the right to enjoy it if I want to.
I smoke occasionally, but I don't think you should. I think you could wait 2 hours if you had to.
But reaction among the non-smokers we talked to was unanimous.
I think it's a wonderful idea because just recently we were held up in an airport and my husband has asthmatic problems and the smoke really bothered him, and when we got back he has now been under heavy medication to clear this all up, and it's strictly from the smoking. So I'm all for it.
What about the smokers who say that this is something they do and they should have a right to do it?
Well, let me put it this way. They ban people spitting because it gives off diseases, and that's how I feel with smoking.
If you can't go for 2 hours without a smoke, you're in really bad trouble.
Smokers would argue that they're paying the same price for a ticket you are, and they should have the right to smoke. What would you say to them?
Well, I won't argue that they're paying the same fare that we are, but I don't know that that gives them the right to inflict their habit on somebody else.
Well, I am allergic to it. I really am, and I just cannot stand it, because if I'm in that atmosphere where there is smoke, I have to get up and leave because I cannot breathe. And I think a lot of people that do smoke, you know, they aren't conscious that this is really a health problem with a lot of other people. They have always done this, and it's not that they're inconsiderate, they just don't think about it.
Supporters of the ban point to studies that indicate health risks to non-smokers breathing secondhand smoke, while the tobacco industry disputes those findings. If there is a risk, flight crews are more vulnerable than most simply because they fly more. Flight attendant Leanne Leitke supports a ban even though she is a smoker.
Smoking, even though it's in the back of the aircraft, can also filter throughout the airplane, and it's very dangerous because of all the fuel that's in an aircraft also.
But you smoke yourself.
That's
many
right.
Smokers say that it should be a right, that they should have to smoke and fly.
I don't think under 2 hours that it's necessary. The flight goes by so fast anyways. I think out of consideration for non-smokers, it should be banned.
There are some studies who say that flight attendants like yourself are at particular risk because you are confined that way.
That's correct. People are inhaling the smoke on the aircraft, no matter if they're smoking or not, or even where they're seated. It makes no difference.
Flight attendant Michelle Carter finds it tough to work under current conditions.
It's very uncomfortable. We work back in it, and if you're on a long flight and you're working in that smoke, it can really bother your eyes, and it just is very uncomfortable.
In July, the House of Representatives voted to ban smoking on all domestic flights of 2 hours or less. Last month, the Senate passed a 2-year trial ban on flights of 90 minutes or less. The differences will be worked out in an upcoming conference. With us now are the author of the Senate bill, Democratic Senator Frank Lautenberg of New Jersey, and a chief opponent, Walker Merriman of the Tobacco Institute, the industry's main trade group. Mr. Merriman, what's wrong with asking people not to smoke for an hour or two? That's not such a terribly long time, is it?
Well, you're certainly right about that. People can go without smoking if they so choose for that period of time. I think, however, that if you look at what the Department of Transportation's complaint record is with respect to what people are talking about on airlines, what they don't like, you'll find smoking in about ninth place. They're more concerned about their baggage, their fares, airline safety. The Airline Pilots Association poll earlier this year said that 87% of the public believes that the present system is fair to smokers and non-smokers.
What about that, Senator Lautenberg?
Well, I can't judge that survey. I would tell you this, that there are other surveys, polls run by the AMA, that says that 80% of the physicians polled believe that there should be a ban on smoking. 67% of the ordinary passengers believe that there should be a ban on smoking in aircraft. And among smokers, 53% of smoking physicians think there ought to be a ban on smoking. Overall, there is overwhelming revulsion against having to inhale someone else's cigarette smoke in an airplane. It's tight quarters. You can't open a window at 30,000 feet. And if, as Mr. Merriman suggests, it's not too much of a burden for an hour and a half or 2 hours to be without a cigarette, then we ought to go ahead, do this to your program, and see what happens.
What about that, Mr. Merriman? I mean, again, the original question, it's not such a long time to ask somebody to give up a cigarette for an hour or two, is it?
No, I don't think it is necessarily. However, I do believe that people who fly are generally satisfied with the present system of smoking and non-smoking sections. The Department of Transportation's complaint record shows that. The Airline Pilots Association public opinion poll shows that. And I don't see any reason for changing the present setup. I think also it's very clear that the scientific evidence that's been done inside airline cabins won't support any belief that smoking in those cabins is going to be a health hazard to non-smoking passengers or flight crew.
Do you buy that?
No, I don't. The Surgeon General has said in a report very recently issued that separating smokers from non-smokers in an airplane may reduce the exposure, but it doesn't eliminate it. They further say that involuntary smoking is a cause of disease, often lung cancer. They say further that it's evidenced by the fact that children who live in smoking homes often have pulmonary respiratory problems, develop less mature lungs in a smoking household than they do in a non-smoking household. And when you confine that to an airplane cabin, the problems get much worse. The National Research Council, Division of Academy of Sciences, confirmed that.
That's pretty devastating evidence, isn't it?
Well, I think if you look at the studies that have been done on aircraft, because that's really what we're talking about, is what's been done on aircraft, you'll find three, one published last month in an environmental journal. And they do not show that the non-smoker's exposure is great. They show, for example, in the most recent research, that a non-smoker would have to fly 8 consecutive New York to Tokyo round trips in order to be exposed to the equivalent of one cigarette. You can't compare that, I don't believe, to what may be the exposure at home, for example, or in other places, because an airline cabin is so much different.
Well, doesn't he have a point about that?
Well, not really, because you have crews exposed. I mean, Mr. Merriman cites the pilot's view. Ask airline crews, see what they say. We've had reports from three union groups pleading with us to stop smoking. The crews, you heard a young stewardess here just now say, though she's a smoker, she wishes that they could ban it in the cabin. And people complain about irritation, they complain about allergies, they complain about all kinds of exposure. And it's time, I think, to say, look, let's stop challenging studies. 50,000 have been done, and yet the people in tobacco industry are unwilling to say there's one of them that's definitive. Once and for all, people are asking for this. I think it's a small give up, frankly, for the smokers. We don't want to change their lifestyle. What we want to do is protect those who smoke involuntarily.
Mr. Merriman, you're not saying that there's no hazard, are you, from secondary smoke, from inhaling the smoke from other people's cigarettes?
What I'm saying, and what's recognized by the scientific community, is that there have been three, not 50,000, there have been three studies done on airlines to determine what the non-smokers' exposure is. Those studies, and presumably, we hope, one that the Department of Transportation will do, because they've said over and over again they don't believe that the present state of scientific knowledge is enough to ban smoking. They want to do the research, and we want to see it done. Those studies do not show that the exposure that the non-smoker gets is a hazard to that individual's health. And I also have to wonder, when this ban goes into effect, if it does, who's going to be responsible for enforcing it? I don't think the flight attendants have really addressed that. I don't think they want to enforce it either.
What about that, Senator?
We've been very,
who will enforce it?
Well, we've been very careful with the way we've drawn this legislation. We're asking that ground personnel be used to enforce a citation that the airline crews will report. They're not going to get involved. They're not going to walk up to someone. They will tell them, you're not allowed to smoke on this aircraft, period. And if someone violates those rules or goes into the lavatory and smokes there illegally, they'll be reported to the ground. And on the ground, we'll have security personnel, either federal marshals or airport security personnel, issue the citation. The system is very simple to work.
What about the other problem that's been raised, and that is that if somebody really loves to smoke and they are asked not to for a couple hours, they may go into the bathroom on the plane and light up and maybe cause a fire.
Well, there are smoke detectors in those lavatories, and there is a severe penalty for tampering with those. Listen, if someone's going to break the law, that doesn't mean you ought not to have the laws. It means that you ought to step up the enforcement. Someone who does that takes enormous risk with all the passengers' lives. And there is enough of a penalty, we think, enough of an incentive not to do it by penalizing $2,000 to $4,000 if they do that.
Okay. Mr. Merriman, what happens if this ban that you all oppose, whether it's temporary or permanent or whatever, goes into effect? What difference does that make for your industry?
Well, I don't know that it makes a great deal of difference in terms of how many cigarettes are sold before the ban versus after the ban. But I do think there are problems that are glossed over here that demand to be addressed, not only the enforcement problem, but the problem of fire safety that I think the pilots are extremely concerned about. I think it's potentially a much greater problem than is being recognized. I do know that the South African Airlines pilots, for example, have pleaded with the government there to rescind the ban because it's causing problems with people going to the laboratories and lighting cigarettes. It might not happen often, but that kind of a fire has never caused a death or an injury in this country before, and I think we ought to want to preserve that record.
Senator.
The Air Canada incident of a few years ago, in which it was believed that smoking in a laboratory was ultimately responsible for substantial loss of life.
But it did not.
There was smoke present. That killed a lot of people on the ground after the airplane had landed. Air Canada responded by banning smoking on flights from Toronto, Montreal to the Newark, New York area. They find that those flights have picked up traffic, that people prefer it, where they have a choice in the Canadian air system between non-smoking flights and smoking, partial smoking flights. They all choose those flights that have non-smoking. The passenger doesn't want this. And it kind of amuses me to hear the suggestion that people will break the law. My gosh, at some point you just don't cave in because people are going to break the law on everything that affects our society.
What do you think is going to happen, Senator? Is this going to be passed in some final form?
I think so. Unless the president vetoes the transportation appropriations bill for other reasons, we're going to have a smoking ban. And my guess, if I had to wager, is that it'll be more like 2 hours than 90 minutes. 90 minutes captures 72% of the flights that take place across this country, and 2 hours takes care of 85% of the flights, and that's what we'd like to see happen.
And I'd like to ask you again, Mr. Merriman, what does it mean if that ban goes into effect for the
airline
industry?
Well, I do think it's going to mean some problems for the airline industry in enforcing it. There's only one airline in this country that's ever tried a smoking ban on all its flights. It wasn't successful. I don't think it's something that people are clamoring for and that they really want. I think also it's very clear that the pilots are concerned about fire safety. No matter how much you try to gloss it over, it only takes one. And I don't think I'd want to be responsible for that.
Wouldn't airplanes be safer without smoking altogether, without any lights and so forth going on in someone's seat?
That'll have to be a question we deal with at another time. But gentlemen, we thank you for being with us. Senator Lautenberg,
thank
Mr.
you.
Merriman, thank you both.
Okay.